Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us. This paper began with a question. Why is everyone so agitated about governments in various countries allowing Huawei into their 5G rollouts? It's a simple, straightforward question. So it began as a curiosity. And the more I began to think about it, the more complex it became. So even if China is not, democracies are free nations. Economic actors are free to do what they want within the confines of their democratically created regulatory frameworks. So this journey started out as an economics paper. But within no time, the paper embraced national security. This changed the way we look at freedom. Then the 5G technology and its far-reaching impact on nations, particularly on national security, infiltrated into the paper. As if this were not enough, the issue of nationality rose. Should India allow its critical infrastructure to be managed by a company from an openly hostile nation like China? So the paper embraced foreign policy and international relations. I believe this integral, multidisciplinary approach has made this paper stronger. I must also admit that although the paper has been published, the ideas underlying it and surrounding it are still a work in progress, as different countries are still exploring their relationships with technology, economics, foreign affairs, and most of all, China. Due to paucity of time, I'm going to quickly go through, this paper has 10 sections, and I'm going to quickly go through each of them to give you a sense of what that section is all about. You can read about it in greater detail. By the way, this is about 13,000 words long. It's perhaps the longest paper I have ever written. It will give you a taste of what lies in the paper. And then, having given you the taste, I will jump to the 9th section, which is of the policy context. So here I start now. Section 1 outlines the power of 5G technology. It explores how it is critical to nations and places the context within which to evaluate firms that manufacture and sell 5G equipment in India. What makes 5G different from 2G, 3G, 4G is speed, of course. Speed is the biggest differentiator. But this speed enables an always-on firms, highly mobile consumers, and fully connected societies. This technology will sit at the center of the fourth industrial revolution, the Internet of Things, smart cities, and self-driven cars. The 5G network should carry a throughput data of 100, which will be about 100 times more than what 4G does. Essentially, this technology enables complex networks to seamlessly interact with each other. To put it in a line, 5G can be visualized as a network of networks. 5G is what is known as critical infrastructure. Critical infrastructure comprises those whose destruction would adversely impact a country's security, economy, or safety. For India to hand over its critical infrastructure to a company from a nation whose leaders are openly hostile to it would be naive. Section 2 shows how a company called Huawei is besieged by a risk called China. As a firm that stands on the cutting edge of technology and offers it at low cost, Huawei would be a logical choice as a back-end equipment provider for any telecommunications firm anywhere in the world. Had the company's nationality been of any other friendly country wanting to do business in India and with India, Huawei would be welcome. But China has been abusing its power, its strength, its economy, and using it against India. Its needless comments on Kashmir, its serially failed attempts at dragging Kashmir into the UN, United Nations Security Council at the behest of Pakistan, its opposition to India to joining the UN Security Council shows China to be, if not an adversary, definitely not a friend. Because the 5G technology will power critical networks that the Chinese state will be able to manipulate, Huawei must not be allowed into India. Section 3 elaborates specific risk in the form of China's national intelligence law that Huawei is legally bound to follow. Under this law, Chinese citizens and companies are bound by and incentivized to gathering intelligence for the Chinese state, even if they are operating in a foreign country, perhaps more so when they are operating abroad. I will read out 4 articles from this law. Article 7, all organizations and citizens shall support, assist, and cooperate with national intelligence efforts in accordance with law and shall protect national intelligence work secrets they are aware of. Article 9. The state gives commendations and awards to individuals and organizations that make major contributions to national intelligence efforts. Article 12. In accordance with relevant state provisions, national intelligence work institutions may establish cooperative relationships with relevant individuals and organizations and retain them to carry out related work. Article 14. National intelligence work institutions lawfully carrying out intelligence efforts may request that relevant organs, organizations, and citizens provide necessary support, assistance, and cooperation. Hence, a Chinese firm is not your usual firm. The shadow of a deep state infiltrates its business decisions. Section 4 observes that China's foreign policy in general, and on India in particular, is motivated by its century of humiliation and argues that the country is weaponizing shame. We constantly hear about how Chinese feel so humiliated and want to break out of their humiliating history. This paper debunks that idea and suggests that China is in fact weaponizing humiliation, using humiliation as a tool of foreign policy, all the while screaming from the rooftops about mutual respect. Section 5 explores where other countries stand in allowing, banning, or fence-sitting around Huawei. This is a dynamic section and a work in progress. For instance, only yesterday we read about how the UK may not allow Huawei in their 5G rollout. China's recent misbehavior with respect to masks or testing kits and leveraging them for Huawei is another example of their strategic urgency. India has so far not banned Huawei. In fact, it has allowed Huawei to conduct 5G trials. COVID-19 is possibly another opportunity where India can reject Chinese firms in their critical infrastructure, as the rest of the world is likely to. Section 6 captures how the trust deficit between India and China prevents India from allowing Huawei to enter and deliver critical infrastructure. It also addresses the attempts by the leaders of the two nations to build trust bridges. While the paper lauds the attempt at building the bridge, it is skeptical of outcomes given China's consistent misbehavior. Section 7 studies the rise of nationalism across the world, including in China and India, and its implication for businesses, consumers, and investors. The paper suggests that even if the Indian government agrees to allow Huawei into its 5G infrastructure, telecommunication service providers may be wary of using it given the lightning speed with which nationalism can overturn their plans. There could be a risk that consumers may simply avoid using service providers that use Chinese equipment. The 20 to 30% discounts that companies get today would be entirely wasted if there are no consumers. Section 8 examines the accentuated security concerns to India due to its 3,488-kilometer-long border with China, fraught with military frictions and strategic tensions. China's intentions being clear, this geography underlines and powers all other arguments against the entry of Huawei into India. So even if the US and European nations allow Huawei into their borders, India must not. India needs to think its own national interest and not be guided by whatever any other country does. Section 9 offers 6 policy contexts within which India should examine the entry of Huawei. More on this later. And Section 10 concludes the paper, reiterating the opening proposition that under current circumstances, India cannot and must not allow Huawei or any other Chinese firm to participate in or deliver critical infrastructure. I will now come to Section 9 and quickly talk about the 6 policy contexts for introducing 5G in India. It is difficult to give policy recommendations in this paper for 2 reasons. First, technology is changing every day. Already, for instance, we are talking about 6G and 7G. Looming ahead is 8G. Second, interstate relations are in a state of disruptive change. Though through this, one thing is clear. China may at best bide its time. Its hostility against India, its interference in India's internal affairs, its support to Pakistan's terror against India will not change. So instead of policy recommendations, this paper attempts to expand the debate and offer 6 policy contexts within which deeper debates can happen. First, indigenization. This may seem counterintuitive in the highly globalized age that we are living in. I'm ignoring the temporary blips in globalization, which are mostly rhetoric. To me, globalization is here to stay. In the case of 5G or 6G or further on, India can't be at the receiving end of either a US-based ecosystem or a China-dominated one. We will have to up our game. This paper gives two examples of this already happening. More are needed. Second, government and business. Given that national security is an area where the government has a monopoly, we may want to extend that monopoly using tools such as BSNL and MTNL. Their sublime failure in the commercial front can be balanced by a restructuring that embeds them into the national security domain. This paper is optimistic, perhaps hopeful, about transforming these dead organizations into islands of excellence like ISRO. Among the various options before us, I believe this one will move the fastest. Once this debate is ignited and priorities and leaderships rethought, it needs to be taken forward. Three, government as enabler. Here the paper looks at creating a three-part ecosystem of policy, knowledge, and execution. The first component of this ecosystem requires the government to adapt to the changing needs of the nation. The second component talks about giving greater freedom to universities and embedding knowledge accountability into them. The third component relates to private enterprises and individuals, where the government must step aside and give greater operating flexibility in research labs, on factory floors, around labor mobility. The three have to work together towards indigenization. We need to turn this trio into a strategic technological force. Fourth, join the techno-nationalism drive. Given that nationalism is the latest idea that's being globalized, India could use it for national security. Japan used techno-nationalism in the past, fusing national security, technology, and industry. China has used 10 key instruments that merge economic growth and strategic control with hegemonic aspirations and nationalism. How this will blend into India's political debates remains to be seen. What also needs to be noted is that countries indulging in techno-nationalism today, US and China, have the rest of their pillars of knowledge, entrepreneurship, industry, and universities in place. India doesn't. COVID-19, the made in China virus, should spur this change in India. My forthcoming paper explores how India needs to rethink its institutions. Fifth, no rush. This paper asks the question, what's the hurry to introduce 5G into India? Smart cities and driverless cars cannot function on India's existing physical infrastructure. India need not, and indeed should not, rush to deliver 5G to its citizens. For best results, the 5G revolution must be preceded by a physical revolution in India. This will give us time to indigenize, see the change in global conversation and technological changes, and enter 5G from a position of strength. A related question is, when the balance sheets of India's telecommunication service providers are bleeding due to a Supreme Court order, who has the money to invest in 5G? Finally, the sixth context is to use Huawei. Despite all other problems, Huawei could serve as an important function. The relatively inexpensive equipment it provides can be used to pull down the prices of other companies. According to senior executives from telecommunication firms that I spoke to, had it not been for Huawei, the benchmark equipment prices from other vendors would have been higher. Those companies, while being more acceptable from a security standpoint, would have extracted their rents through a less competitive business environment. Lack of competition would also have facilitated product complacency and pricing dominance. Thus, Huawei can be seen as a pricing watchdog, more efficient than any regulator or government in commercial space. I will conclude by reading a line from this paper, which encapsulates the conclusion of this paper. Beijing cannot expect economic returns from India without making commensurate investments in building strategic ties. To rephrase, China has to climb its way up the trust vanguards of India before it enters the trust vaults of India. Thank you very much.